And yet, there's a blank slate when we talk about the history of America and so forth, of George Washington and Thomas Jefferson and James Madison. Were not these virtuous men? Were not they standard bearers for justice and democracy and freedom and all men being created equal? Yes. But what about slavery? They were all slaveholders. They owed their wealth to claiming the lives of black people. That's a fact of history. It's not only a fact, it's the truth. When you add value to it, it's the truth. You know, things can be facts, and you know, you gotta bring some value to it in order for it to be the truth. But we can't acknowledge that. And this is why we have a race problem. The founders of the American nation were white supremacists. The institutions that they built were based on racial domination. That's what white supremacy means. It just doesn't mean racism like we use the word today, as if it's some virus that individuals can catch, you know, like I can catch the virus of racism and therefore I become racist, you know, like some disease. So racism means white supremacy. The racists in this country are white people, because the basis of racism is institutional. That's what makes it work. The government, the education system, religious institutions, the labor institutions. Every institution in this country is founded on the principle of white domination over black people. That's what racism is. It doesn't make white people being inherently racist. That's not what I'm saying. Nobody's born with racist genes. That's nonsense. We're talking about an ideology and indoctrination of the people of this country. And we all live under the umbrella of race. That's an idea, and racism, that's the action from the idea. The ism gives race action. It makes it real in life. Race itself is a myth. It creates the reality of racism. Are you following me? A lot of that goes on in the world, and that's because of the way language is used. You can take language and create things that don't even exist.
Like race, created in the 1700s for the purpose of separating the worker from the non-worker. And then they told you a whole bunch of lies and built a bunch of propaganda and wrote it down in history so we believe George Washington never told a lie. And Thomas Jefferson never said Sally Hemings' name. And Strom Thurmond was a great segregationist in Congress but had a black daughter. You see, the contradictions and crazy making of race come out of this context of the transatlantic slave trade and all of the crazy making that's happened for the imprisonment of black people. And our young people are marching, and we ask ourselves, do black lives matter? Should they do things that inconvenience Minnesota or not? Well, death is inconvenient for black people, so I say they should go ahead and march, and if they need me to march with them, then I will march with them. We need to be thinking about our children being on the front lines of protest as they were in 1963, 64, 65, and beyond. They filled the jails on our behalf, so we would get up. So tonight, I'm pleased to introduce to you Professor Nimtz. Did I say it correctly?
Yes.
Who's coming to us to talk about the transatlantic slave trade and free our minds tonight. Welcome to the first step toward your liberation. We're delighted you're here. There is a chair that's free up here. There's another one that's free up here. And the professor will take it away. We're delighted to have you. Thank you, Professor.
Thanks very much, Lisa and Mahmoud, for inviting me. Mahmoud and I go way back, and and it's a real pleasure to be here and to be a part of this discussion with you. And I'm always available to come back and to be a part of the discussions. Yes. Yeah, August, just like the month, is the first name, and it's spelled. Yeah, okay. Good. Yeah, I'm glad you have the leaflets and some, because I, I don't have a map, but I want to make use of that map that's on the leaflet and so on. It's very very instructive. As most of you know, in the last week or so, we learned once again how integrated the world is economically. The developments in China have had repercussions and will continue to have repercussions into the future. I begin with that because there was no institution that played as important a role in integrating us economically on a global basis as the Atlantic slave trade. That's the origins that's the origins of international economic integration. It was the Atlantic slave trade that made that possible. Just to back up a little bit, slavery as an institution is very old. It's an ancient institution. There's reference to it in the Bible. In fact, some of the slave owners used to like to make use of the references in the Bible to try to justify the institution of slavery. It's an ancient institution. But with the Atlantic slave trade, it takes on a new, qualitatively different form. It's the beginning of what we sometimes call racial slavery. Prior to the Atlantic slave trade, slavery in general was not associated with a particular group of people. In ancient Roman slavery, was an equal opportunity employer. The slaves came from all kinds of different backgrounds and different skin colors in the Roman Empire. The same thing in Greece. With the Atlantic slave trade, however, we begin to see the emergence of racial slavery, where slaves become associated with a particular group of people. That's the origins of racial slavery, and what we still live with, the legacy of that is what we're still grappling with and struggling with today. This is a good time to be talking about the Atlantic slave trade. There's a lot of new research going on around the question of slavery, new discoveries. Some of you may have heard about 6 months ago, a sunken ship, was found off the coast of South Africa. And I don't know if they'll be able to transfer the ship or not, but the head of the new museum in Washington, D.C., Lonnie Bunch, wants to see some of the artifacts from that he's been looking. Okay.
Just in case.
Okay, good. Thanks, man. The teacher. Yeah. Some of those artifacts will find their way into the museum. I didn't know that as extensive and as long as the slave trade existed, we never had any real ships. The actual ships and what were on the ships, we simply didn't have. Those had disappeared in history. And so this discovery off the coast of South Africa is the first, provides us with an opportunity now to leave the world of abstraction and to actually have concrete evidence of a slave ship. The fact that it was off the coast of South Africa is important because the ship itself originated in Mozambique, and therefore on the Indian Ocean. And I mention that because it gives you a sense of how the Atlantic slave trade went beyond the Atlantic Ocean. It integrated parts of the Indian Ocean, and this ship was on its way with about 400 to 500 slaves on its way to Brazil, which was a Portuguese territory, and it sunk. There was a storm, and the ship sunk off the coast of Cape Town, near Cape Town, South Africa. Not surprisingly, the captain and the crew all escaped. About half of the slaves, we think, lost their lives in that particular wreck. But we now have concrete evidence for the first time, and some of that will be on display at the museum. I think the museum is scheduled to open
2016.
Okay, good. 2016. Yeah, it's important. It's a very important development and so on. In addition to that discovery, there have been a number of developments also taken, but especially in scholarship. A number of new books have come out on the question of slavery, looking at the global implications of slavery, the economics of it, and again, how it helped to integrate the world. A new book on cotton, on the global implications of cotton, which I want to come back to, is perhaps the most detailed account we have showing the economics of slavery. Some of the museums that are now beginning to open. I was just reading the other day there's going to be one in Beaufort, South Carolina, to deal with the whole question of reconstruction. Mahmoud and I were down in Beaufort and Frogmore many years ago, Robert Small Country, and that museum is going to be opening, the first museum to deal with the whole topic of reconstruction.
What's the museum
called? I don't know, but there's an article, if you look, Reconstructing Reconstruction is the article that was in the New York Times about a week ago, taking another look at the Reconstruction era. There's another museum that's opening up in Long Island, New York. And this is important because we usually think of slavery as being a Southern institution. And it's slowly being acknowledged, you know, this was a national institution. And this site, this museum that's going to open up in near Sag Harbor or the Hamptons on Long Island will be a first to the plantation system that existed on Long Island. This is the roots and the origins of this. So there's a lot of research, a lot of discussion that's going on. It's just a very healthy discussion. I think indeed the discussion around the tragic events in South Carolina and Charleston opened up all possibilities. I think a big breakthrough, the film 12 Years a Slave, I think was an extremely important breakthrough in giving us a sense of what this institution, the brutality of this institution. So I think we're living in very good times, I think, to have this discussion have an honest discussion about it for the first time. Again, slavery as an institution is very old. It's a very old institution. The Atlantic slave trade, however, was able to quote-unquote modernize, corporatize slavery in a way it had never been before. It became part of an economic system that's sometimes known as mercantilism. And mercantilism was a particular economic philosophy which argued that the way to enrich a society was to have the government control economic activities, government involvement in economic activities. It was against the doctrine of mercantilism that an economist by the name of Adam Smith wrote a diatribe against mercantilism, known as The Wealth of Nations, in 1776, sort of the founding document of the capitalist mode of production. But the mercantilist doctrine had been in place for at least three centuries, and it was that doctrine that state-sponsored economic activities and so on, that's what the Atlantic slave trade became a part of. Within Africa, within Europe, within Asia, all continents, South America and so on, there were forms of slavery, bonded labor, that went way back. I know of no continent that is without some form of bonded labor. It's generally, my reading of history is that it's generally confined to a minority within society. The vast majority of societies didn't practice slavery. But there were degrees. There were degrees of bonded labor. I remember interviewing someone in East Africa many years ago who had been a slave in Tanzania when I was doing research, and I asked him how did it happen? How did you become a slave? And he explained, and in a way that I would only learn later was oftentimes very common. Debt slaves, falling into debt. Falling into debt was oftentimes the way in which someone found themselves becoming a slave, to pay back a debt. You've got to provide labor in order to pay back the debt. And that's one of the most common ways in which people may find themselves falling into, some of us refer to the today's world, that many of us become debt slaves. Debt slaves. But debt is oftentimes the origins from one society to another. With the Atlantic slave trade, what happens is that people who found themselves in bonded labor with amongst various African peoples and so on, that becomes integrated into now this new international corporate institution backed by European state governments. And the key states, of course, are first Spain and Portugal. Spain and Portugal lead the way. They're in the vanguard of the Atlantic slave trade. They are displaced by the Dutch, who would later, and the French, the Danes and the Swedes, and then later the English. And what you see here is a steady progression of one emerging mercantilist capitalist power displacing the other. Spain again is in the vanguard, but Spain loses out to the Dutch, to the Swedes, to the Danes, to the French, and then later to the English. So by the time of the end of the Atlantic slave trade, England is the key. England is the key operative, the key institute, the key country, the key government, and so on, that's sponsoring, that is promoting the Atlantic slave trade. So it begins with the discovery of the so-called discovery of the New World. Process of looking for labor in order to bring value to these new colonies in the New World is what driving this process. You have to see it as a money making. It's about making money. It's about greed. That's when the colonies are set up in the New World, they have to pay for themselves. We have to find out a way. Who's going to pay for it? They have to make money. They have to be profitable, and they become investment opportunities. And one of the most famous philosophers of democracy and liberty, was an investor in the Virginia and in the Carolinas. In these corporations involved in the slave trade. I'm talking about John Locke. Locke was one of the investors. This is the way you made money. So you, just like we invest in corporations today, that's what the slave trade was about. The colonists had to make money. And one of the problems that the colonists made, and I'll draw a lot on the U.S. case, which I know the best, is that the colonists thought that they could make use of labor from Europe, from England in particular, indentured labor. It's important to remember that the institution of racial slavery in the United States especially comes out of the institution of indentured servitude. There was an institution in Europe, in England in particular. And this is something that we oftentimes tend to forget about, and that is within Europe, slavery was in place. Europeans, quote unquote, enslaved other Europeans. But That was one of the most famous cases, of course, was the Irish. When the English went into the second time into Ireland, Cromwell in particular, over 100,000 Irish were enslaved and were sent to the Caribbean. It's no accident that the word slave is very similar to another word referring to a group of people in Europe, the Slavs, the Slavic-speaking peoples. That particular part of Europe was a place where slave raids were carried out by the Romans and others. You went that particular part of the world. It's not an accident that the word slave and Slav are very similar. So within Europe, it's important to understand that the institution of slavery was very much in place in the Mediterranean world. The plantation systems that would come to Africa and later to the United States had their origins in the Mediterranean world. They were the legacy of what the Romans had done, had been inherited down in time. And so that, I'm trying to say this to give you a sense that the Atlantic slave trade just didn't appear out of nowhere. It had roots. It had long roots. It's true, it becomes something qualitatively different than what had existed before, but these are the roots of the Atlantic slave trade. So yes, the colonies, Virginia, we just had an important discovery about Virginia a few weeks ago, a discovery where the first settlement in Virginia, Roanoke Island, right off near Cape Hatteras and so on, that particular part of North Carolina and so on. Yeah, that was the first English settlement. Well, Spanish had been there before. Always remember the Spanish had been in North America before the English. St. Augustine, Florida, of course, is the oldest city in the United States. It was a Spanish city. But the defeat of the Armada, the Spanish Armada by Elizabeth I, is what will lead to the demise of the Spanish. And the Spanish there will begin to take a back seat more and more to the English. All right. So the colony that was set up in Virginia to make money was an investment opportunity to grow tobacco. And the original assumption was that they would make use of indentured servants from England. Indentured servants from England, that was the idea. They began to realize that it wasn't going to work. The death toll in the colony and so on was extremely high. The vast majority of the colonists simply did not survive. And so these investors therefore had a labor problem. Somebody's got to do the work. We need labor. We've got to look for labor somewhere. And it is this desire, this quest in search of labor that it takes these investors to Africa. Africa becomes more and more as the place from which to look for this labor. There were other developments within Europe, especially England, that explains why there was a labor shortage. You couldn't get as many indentured servants to come. And when I say indentured servants, I'm referring to whites, European whites. But the first African slaves in Virginia were known as indentured servants. What happens in Virginia over a period of time is that some indentured servants with a certain skin color become permanent indentured servants. And that's a process that takes place. You can see in the legal system, one law after another. It's important, again, that first group of Africans who land in Virginia come as indentured servants, which means that after a certain period of time, they can get their freedom. By 1644, 1650, 1670, and so on, that comes to an end. And those particular indentured servants with this particular skin color will become permanently bonded, cannot leave. This is how the institution comes into existence over time. It was known, of course, Spain and Portugal had had contact with Africa going way back. The Iberian Peninsula, for people who know the ties between North Africa and Spain and Portugal, goes way back in history. So there was knowledge, commercial relations known. And so the decision was made to look to Africa. It was cheaper It was cheaper to bring Africans into the New World. And keep in mind that the largest number would come to Brazil and the Caribbean. Only about 10% of the 12 million who were taken out of Africa. About 12 million were taken out of Africa. About 2 million died in the process, in the enslavement process and so on, and in the transference process. But of the 12.5 million he came out, almost 80% will be going to Brazil and into the Caribbean. And a lot of that had to do with simply the reality of growing the major crop. The crop that was pushing this, of course, was sugar production. And you couldn't grow sugar in the northern climes of the United States, but in the Caribbean, it's a tropical product. And so only with the overthrow of slavery in Haiti would sugar production come to the United States. And when it came to the United States, it came to southern Louisiana, where the climate was suitable in order to have that particular. So yeah, sugar. Sugar is what leads, that's the main product that's being produced to make money in order to be able to boost investment and profits. In the 19th century, it would be cotton. Sugar would be less important, and cotton would become far more important. And cotton would, the promotion of cotton would have enormous implications for the future of industrial capitalism. We sometimes refer to the Atlantic slave trade, one of the key features, we sometimes refer to it as the triangular trade. The triangular trade. And it's called the triangular trade if this is the U.S. over in this direction, the New World, Brazil, and so on, and this is England. The triangular trade refers to the fact that as slaves are taken out of Africa and brought to the New World to produce sugar and then later cotton, that product is then shipped to the United States or to England to be manufactured into manufactured goods. And then the manufactured goods are then taken back to Africa in order to trade for the slaves. This is what we call the triangular trade. Again, the slaves are taken out of Africa, brought to the New World to produce the raw crops materials, first sugar and then later cotton, indigo, tobacco, or the other kinds of crops, rice. Those products are taken to either North America, the New England area especially, or to Europe, specifically England. They are manufactured goods such as cloth, for example. The cloth is then taken to West Africa in order to trade for more slaves. Now, what this means, and we can talk about it, Mahmoud and I talked a little bit about this earlier, and we should just put it out there on the table, we can have a discussion. Who were the people in Africa then who were involved in the slave trade? Who were the middlemen and so on? The merchants and so on? Exactly who were they? We can talk about that later, but I'm simply saying, I want to acknowledge now that yes, somebody's involved in the process on this end. Somebody is selling the slaves in exchange for the, say, the textiles.
So can you go over one more time, it's from Africa to the Caribbean, Brazil, and then what's after that?
Right, it's the raw materials are taken to be manufactured, either in the United States, in the New England area, or in England.
Either one.
Those, both of them are manufacturing centers, especially England. And especially with the textiles and so on. So the cotton from the United States goes almost always to England, especially in the 19th century. This is why the English elite supported the Confederacy during the Civil War. As Karl Marx once said, without slavery, there would be no modern capitalism. The textile industry. And those textiles are taken again to West Africa to be traded, along with guns, by the way. Along with guns. Because the guns will be very useful for those involved in the capturing process. The guns will become very important and deadly.
to, as a part of the capturing process. And one of the things we know, this is one of, I'm drawing a lot, especially a person who was really in the vanguard of this kind of research, in my opinion, from our generation, was Walter Rodney. And it's still a classic book I recommend highly to everyone, called How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. Mm-hmm. How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. Yeah, very, very important. And it's relevant in this context because one of the things that Rodney argues is that by taking the textiles, the manufactured textiles to West Africa, it undermined indigenous textile manufacturing in West Africa. It was able to undercut it, sell it cheaper. So what happens is that African entrepreneurs, manufacturers and so on, go out of business. And what's set up is a development we see today. If you're trying to understand the lack of manufacturing and so on, why is it that so many African countries are dependent on manufactured products either from China or wherever in the case? Yes, indigenous manufacturing, what had might have been in incipient capitalist development and so on in West Africa, that's undermined. That's undermined with these cheap manufactured products coming into West Africa. It undermines indigenous development. So more and more, Africa becomes more and more dependent. More and more dependent without actually having any control, any say-so about this development that's slowly taking place over time. And I argue it goes a long way to the relevance of why we talk about this topic. It goes a long way in explaining the reality of underdevelopment in West Africa. One of the interesting pieces of arguments that Rodney made is one of the tragedies of the slave trade is that it encouraged what we call sometimes the balkanization of people. Those involved in the slave trade now had an incentive to raid other groups. If you raid other groups, you can get slaves. One of the easiest ways in order to get slaves, raiding other people. So what happened, you're pitting peoples off against one another. At one time in West Africa, we had political units that were much more expansive, much more inclusive. With the slave trade encourages balkanization, provincialism, splitting peoples up, dividing people from one another. And there's been a famous study that was done in the last few years, which argues quite convincingly by a West African scholar, that because of this process and the length in which it lasted, you find high levels of distrust amongst people, the various people, having experienced this process. And we know this had repercussions. One of the problems when dealing with the Ebola epidemic was the distrust that many people had about their governments. One of the problems of the Ebola epidemic, and this West African scholar argues that this legacy of distrust has its origins in the slave trade, where people are pitted against one another looking for slaves in order to sell to the merchants at the coast. And it facilitated, so by 1900, between 1850 and 1900 of the First World War, when England and France and Germany were able to come into Africa and relatively easy establish colonies. You've always wondered, well, why were Europeans colonies established in Africa? By 1900, the balkanization, the divisions and so on, people preying on one another, made it easier for outside powers to intervene and to impose their will on African peoples. And that's that legacy. It's a legacy that we still live with until today. We also know one of the things that Rodney argued is that the slave trade, because of the very nature of slave trading, what it was all about, for profit making and for labor and so on, you ended up taking the most productive people within the society out. They're the ones who got exploited. You wanted a particular labor, a young men, especially between ages about 15 and about 35 years old. You wanted the most productive people. And so as a result, we lose we lose some of our most productive people to the slave trade. There's still some parts of Africa, especially Angola, where the population density is much more sparse than it is, say, in a place like Nigeria. And we think the reason for that, if you look at Angola maybe is about the size of Nigeria in terms of geographically and so on, but it has maybe a tenth or less of the population of Nigeria. And we think that has to do with the legacy of the slave trade. That is taking people. It's no accident, by the way, that the state prison in my home state of Louisiana is called Angola. That's Angola became associated with the source of slaves. So we're losing our most productive individuals, and the balkanization, and what happens in terms of the big picture is that in the world of 1500, approximately 1500, we can make a case, Rodney makes a convincing case, that the standard of living for the average European and for the average African was of minimal difference. In the world of 1500, you go back and look at what the world looked like in Africa in 1500 on average, and in Europe on average, the standard of living was about the same. By 1900, that's over with. By 1900, the changes, the disruption, the underdevelopment that has taken place as a result of this is of enormous. That gap is the gap that we are still grappling with, trying to deal with today. Let me just conclude by talking about the end of this. How did this come to an end? It's true that slavery and capitalism go hand in hand. At a certain, contrary to Adam Smith, in the magic of the marketplace and so on, certainly in the early years of capitalist development, as Karl Marx, I think, accurately said, without slavery, there would be no industrial revolution. Why did he say that? The key development in the industrial revolution is textiles. Textile. Think about the steam engine. Think about the textile industry. England leads the way. Well, where did the raw material from the textiles come from? From the South, the U.S. South. From the slaves in the United States. And this is when Mahmoud was talking about the wealth of the slave. See, that's what made slave labor in the United States so wealthy. Why it was so had the value it did, because it was linked to the Industrial Revolution. That's what made it so valuable. And so when the slave owners lost their property and didn't get compensated, Lincoln tried to compensate. He made an offer. He tried to buy the slaves. They wouldn't take the offer. They had derived so much wealth from this. They had no interest in selling, trying to cut a deal. And it was only when they wouldn't cut a deal that Lincoln realized that this will have to be taken forcibly. And it's the greatest property confiscation in modern history. The greatest property confiscation. Yes, I know today they don't want to talk about it being property, but we all know better, as Mahmoud is, as the president of the Confederacy made very clear at the time of the secession, this is our property. And that property right was embedded in the U.S. Constitution. Go back, read Article 4. Read Article 4 in the U.S. Constitution. It's an article that's a little embarrassing for some of the defenders of the Constitution. But that's the article where it states very clearly, if my property runs away to another state, I want it back. And the government is obligated to return my property, in other words, a slave. If my slave runs away, another state is obligated to return it. All of us in Minnesota should know about the history of this, because the most famous case, the Dred Scott case. Dred Scott, as you know, spent some time at Fort Snelling. But it's the most famous of these cases around the question of the fugitive slaves. And the return of the slaves. So yes, the slaves were regarded as property, first and foremost. And also the Fifth Amendment. There's a It's oftentimes forgotten. There's a clause in the Fifth Amendment that the government cannot confiscate your property. Well, that's exactly what Lincoln did. That's exactly what Lincoln did. And he was a lawyer, and so he was worried that he had really violated the Constitution. He claimed he did so on the basis of his military powers, that he could carry out this confiscation as a part of the war. He had the right to confiscate property given his presidential military powers and so on. But just to play safe, he wanted to make sure then that there'd be a new amendment to the Constitution, the 13th Amendment, to give him legal protection. And not just him, but he was concerned that a subsequent president, someone like who came after him? Andrew Johnson would try to restore, which he did, try to restore slavery. So he wanted an amendment. By the way, the amendments have been in the news recently, especially the 14th Amendment. I don't know if people follow the discussion on the 14th Amendment. The question of birthright citizenship. A number of the Republican candidates want to get rid of birthright citizenship. Birthright citizenship is in the U.S. Constitution in response to the Dred Scott decision. In the Dred Scott decision in 1857, the Supreme Court ruled that African Americans have no rights, were not intended to be citizens. The framers never intended for them to be citizens of the United States. That's what the 1857 Dred Scott decision did. So just because you're born, in other words, just because you're born in the United States doesn't make you a citizen. That's what the Dred Scott decision said. So the 14th Amendment was an attempt to overturn that decision. And so that's where the birthright citizenship provision comes from during the Reconstruction period. Yes, the Civil War was a key development in the ending of the Atlantic slave trade. It's the beginning of the end. In hindsight, we see the beginning of the end in a bit earlier with the Haitian Revolution. I can't emphasize enough the importance of the Haitian Revolution. This was a revolution. The Haitians went up successfully against three of the mightiest armies in the world and defeated them. Not only the French, but the British and the Spanish. Not only the French, but also the Spanish and the English. And this Haitian Revolution was such a threat to the slave owners of the United States that people like Thomas Jefferson considered blocking with Napoleon to try to overthrow the Haitian Revolution. If you were a slave owner in the United States, the last thing you wanted was to have an example of slaves who had risen up and overthrew their slave owners. That's a bad example. And this goes a long way, by the way, in explaining why Haiti was isolated for such a long time. In the economic crisis, the economic difficulties that Haiti faced have their origins. Haiti was isolated. Nobody wanted to touch them. They had no friends in the world. But in hindsight, we know that this was the beginning. This was the beginning of the end of the Atlantic slave trade in the United States. It had an echo. In 1808, according to the Constitution, the Atlantic slave trade, that is, no more slaves could be brought into the United States from Africa after 1808. That was one of the compromises reached at the Constitutional Convention. After 1808, no new slaves could be brought into the United States from Africa. One of the reasons for it, we know, is that the Virginia crowd, the Virginia delegates, had a particular interest. You would wonder why Virginia is a slave state. Why would they be interested in having this provision in the Constitution? No new slave. Well, what it did, it drove up the price, the value of the slaves in Virginia. Virginia was the largest slave-owning state. So if you know that there's no new supply coming in, it's going to increase the value of your slaves. And by that time, Virginia's major export is no longer tobacco. Virginia's major export by 1808 is slaves to the South, to Mississippi, to Alabama, and elsewhere. My family on my mother's side is where we have our roots. Coming out of Virginia, the slaves who were sent to New Orleans, who were sold
who was sold in New Orleans. So Virginia is very much into the slave trade, that is exporting. So the Constitution said there could be no new slaves coming to the United States after 1800, but the Constitution did not bar the internal slave trade. So the internal slave trade was alive and well, and the only thing that would bring that to an end, of course, was in the Civil War. Slaves were being brought into Cuba as late as the last slaves brought into Cuba were in 1868. In Brazil, slavery was still in place in Brazil as long as it didn't officially come to an end into 1888. But by the time, because what was happening in the United States, it was clear that the handwriting was on the wall for Brazil. This is why every slave owner in Cuba, in Brazil, followed closely the Civil War. The ships that would bring in the newspapers from the United States, slave owners in Brazil would be waiting at the docks to read the newspapers to hear how the war was going. They knew if the Confederacy lost, this would be the end for slave owners in Brazil and elsewhere. And that's exactly what began to happen. So yes, this was it was a century-long process. And I can't emphasize enough the importance of Haiti, but also in the United States, because when the war breaks out, what happens is that slaves in the United States, our forebears, they take advantage of the opportunity and begin leaving the plantations. There's an exodus from the plantation. We are looking for every opportunity we can to get out from under the slave master's gun. And so you've got this exodus, and the slaves themselves, their exodus and wanting to join, to sign me up to be a part of the army in order to be able to fight against the slave owner, all that begins to weaken the institution of slavery. It took a war, a very bloody war, to get rid of these slave owners that were not interested in willingly giving up their property. This was their property.